Animal traces are like an ancient language. Wild animals use this language to write on the earth and communicate with one another. Different types of traces reveal different messages. In the past, adept traditional hunters could determine various kinds of subtle messages left by wild animals and trace them accordingly. Later on, ecologists also understood animals' behaviors and habits through their traces. Today, filmmakers also follow animal traces to find them. I got involved with the filming project of tracing sambars in 2003 by chance. In the beginning, I was not familiar with the language of traces and could only get some short footage of the sambar from a distance after spending a great effort. When I slowly learned to understand and mingle with them, the distance between us gradually shortened. Finally, in the mountainous area of Panshi, Dahuang became my best friend. After finishing setting up my camp, my favorite thing to do was to go to a nearby mountain peak and shout at Dahuang out loud. He would always appear in front of me, looking at me quietly and overbearingly, as if looking at some alien ambassador. Are you happy? Such extraordinary sambar horns. After it turned away, a domineering impression occupied my mind. So breathtaking. In the winter of 2005, while the filming project of tracing sambars was on the last filming mission, Dahuang was nowhere to be seen in the whole Panshi mountain area. In the summer and fall of 2006, some new male sambars arrived in Panshi, but still no sight of Dahuang. I began to worry about his safety. He had turned from prime time into an elderly stage. His physical body had weakened. How would he survive the coming winter? With great concern and little hope, I returned to Panshi on a cold day. The temperature, giving the hibernating earth ways to make sounds, as if to talk and light sleep, is a sign of waking up. Freshly melted snow, forming a small puddle on the silver blanket, like the half-opened eye. The shoot of plants point their heads out, like quivering eyelashes, revealing the breath of spring from sleepiness. Squirrels and birds, anxious for the snow to melt, rush out to find food. Finally, finding a nut, the hard work is worthy. Most of the sambars leave here way before heavy snow falls, seeking food in the forest at lower altitudes, and then disappear. However, the snowy land keeps the best records of animals' activities. As long as they are active in the area, they will leave clear footprints. Can this sambar be Dahuang? From the distance between its footprints, the size of this sambar is not too large. Not like the king of Panshi in my heart. The buds of rhododendron flowers were formed a year ago, going through a brutal winter and blossoming in the warmer springtime. they become extraordinarily beautiful. From April every year, they announce the arrival of spring on the grassy land in the high mountains. Meanwhile, the sambars migrate from forests at lower altitudes, returning here. These are fallen sambar firs. As the weather gets warmer, the sambars are ready to grow new firs, and their bodies look spotted. The fallen sambar firs, a material frequently used by birds to build nests. Like the inner layer of this robin's nest, which is made with sambar firs. It is soft and comfortable, providing very effective insulation. Male sambars shed their horns from the past year and start growing new ones. Soft sambar horns make the male sambars less domineering and also turn their temper milder. These new sambars do not know me at all, and thus were suspicious of my existence. Now, without a defense weapon, they keep me away at a respectful distance. Without Dahuang, Panshi Mountain becomes so lonesome. Many high mountain plants grow new shoots at this time. They not only put on new clothes for the earth, but also provide a new food choice for the sambars. And their staple has enlarged from only Yushania to include shoots of rhododendrons and Yushan roses, all of which are fine quality spring delicacies. Grazing sometimes can become a form of creativity, like on the edge of those forests which more sambars inhabited. The tree leaves underneath a certain height were all eaten, and a faint line can be seen from a distance, indicating how high they can reach. After 3 to 4 months, the growth of a new sambar's horns is complete. Now, the sambar's horns begin to harden, and their outer skin rapidly withers. Is it itchy? Male sambars always try to rub away that velvet skin in order to polish the sambar horns. They will choose smaller sized trees to rub their horns, perhaps so they can do a more thorough job in finer areas. As a result, the bark of many young trees has been entirely removed in a ring-like shape. This tree's bark was circularly removed by the sambars, and the tree is about to die. However, not from rubbing of their horns. Observing closely, teeth marks can be found, tearing upwards. Therefore, this is the trace that a sambar has been grazing on it. Grazing can remove tree bark in large sizes. And even a large size tree with a diameter of over 50 centimeters can be killed by tree bark removal in ring-like shapes. Colors are freely decorated among clusters of green leaves. The earth suddenly brightens up, and life is about to speed up to have some fun time together. mother sambars always bring sambars several months old to seek for food on the mountain hills. And male sambars, always rubbing their horns, are getting ready for the approaching mating season. I always take advantage of this season, getting up to the mountains and shooting some more footage. Of course, I hope to see Dahuang again. From the number of sambar horn splits, we can roughly estimate their ages. Young male sambars grow the base of their horns after they are 8 months old, and a single sambar horn after they are 2 years old, taking up the Y-shaped form when they are three, and further growing into two joints and three tips when they are 4 years old, and remain like this throughout their lives. As the size of their horns extends in circumference, the length of their main horns also increases. Water puddles, or mud puddles, are the most favorable hangout spot of mature male sambars. They are here not for a bath, but for meeting girls. When male sambars are tumbling around, they fuse all the secretory scents from their bodies into the muddy water. They even mix in their own urine to intensify the scent, which means they are more easily noticed by the female sambars. They cover their bodies with mud and rub their bodies against the grassy brushes or their horns on the trees, marking their scents all around them. They also rub their faces on trees or harrow the land with their feet, since the glands that secrete scents are located between the male sambar's toes and underneath their eyes. They're unable to find out what smell the female sambars like. Still, this method seems to work. Meanwhile, the male sambars will closely follow the female sambars, sniffing them constantly. Perhaps they want to know if the female sambars are already in the estrous state and suitable for mating. Generally, Formosan sambars are not particularly territorial, and many male sambars roaming in the same area can be frequently seen. There is also no obvious individual boundaries in the puddles where male sambars take mud baths. They can mostly accept sharing the same puddle with other male sambars. But even so, it is still rare to see male sambars roaming together. Grazing together like buddies, as these two are, usually only happens with younger males. The bathing puddle is the most bustling place in the mountains on a summer day. This was not so obvious during the day, but in the dark night, through filming by the infrared night vision camera, the scene has been completely captured. My favorite thing to do in my leisure time, apart from shooting film, is to freely roam around the puddle, enjoying the ever-changing scenery while observing the sambar's behaviors. Once at the shore of Jiaming Lake, sambars stayed away from the lake due to my presence. They congregated on the hill nearby, grazing on the grass, playing a waiting game. After the sun had set and the light dimmed, they finally mustered up the courage and approached the lake. A baby sambar first popped up its head and looked around in a gap on the ridge. It began moving toward the lake without looking back, and several full-grown sambars followed it. This is no big deal, But the last one, following behind, was the only large-sized male deer. I couldn't help but laugh, wondering if we should say it's courteous to the young and weak, or bullying them. Of course, nothing excites me more than watching the fights between two male deers interlocking horns. This behavior is so rare to be seen, even for experienced ecologists. I've been fortunate enough to witness it a few times, all in dimmed light settings. Real fighting actually doesn't happen that frequently. Usually, as long as the stronger deer thrusts out its chest and stamps its feet, demonstrating its power, the weaker one will get the message and leave. Only when both sides are with equal standing, the behavior of interlocking horns can be seen. There is no fixed procedure for interlocking horns. Sometimes one battle will have a result, other times one side does not leave the matter at that. The fruits, preserving a summer frenzy into deposits of energy for the continuation of the life force, are now ready to give back to the earth. Compared with colorful foliage that are about to fall, they are more reserved. Animals know when the harvest should come and put an end to the extravagance. I still heard nothing back from Dahuang and began wandering myself. One day, I came to a creekside ridge overlooking lapping peaks and winding rivers. A Sambar's bolt woke me up with a startle. I saw a black bear walking out from the forest. Ignoring the surrounding commotion, it walked upstream along the creek. The Sambars that were previously in that area had already run away in an instant. This unexpected encounter is the harvest of the fall. The air, frozen within the sparkling ice and frost, has a sense of desperate beauty. It causes one to be more out of breath than the thinness of the air. The snow is falling again. Some elderly Sambars will eventually become unable to withstand the bad weather and die in the cold winter. Corpses are actually traces from animal activities. They belong to the original form of life, thus I don't feel too much affected by it. However, a friend's photograph of a Sambar's skull kept me up all night. That Sambar died from old age. The surfaces of its molars were almost grounded flat, and its horns were so familiar. The time has returned to 5 years ago. If this really is Dahuang's skull, then I shall be gratified for him, because it was really a natural death. His life not only has enriched the high mountainous, grassy lands of Taiwan, it has also nourished my life and has become the strength to support me. I can't wait to get back to the mountains to look for this skull. Seeing it with my own eyes allows me to further confirm that it is Dahuang. I express my gratitude to him and look at the flowers and plants growing next to his skull, thinking that these lives, perhaps just like mine, were also nourished by the same life. Many Sambars are not as lucky as Dahuang. They might die due to injury and illness, or get killed by hunters. According to the indigenous people, the yellow-throated martens would congregate in small groups to hunt plant-eating animals such as Formosan Reeves muntjac and sambars. However, their primary natural enemy is still humans. Like all living beings, humans and sambars are just parts of the ecosystem. And the numbers of their groups will grow and decline due to competition and hunting activities. Human activities affect sambars' living conditions, and equally, the increasing numbers of sambars also has an effect on the biodiversity of local lives. At places where more sambars are active, the fargesia become sparse, and some birds that utilize fargesia to build their nests are affected. Mild spring breeze once again, waking up the sleeping high mountains. The new year brings forth new things and new life. After 8.5 months of pregnancy, female sambars find secluded brushes and give birth to their offspring. After falling down again and again, the baby sambars stand up within 20 minutes after they are born, and they seek their mother's breasts for milk. Unlike the little baby deer Bambi in our conventional impression, there are almost no spots on their bodies, which is the best protective camouflage for the Formosan sambars. Shortly after the babies are born, the mother deer discharges the placenta and eats it entirely to avoid leaving any smell that may attract their enemies. When it is 1 month old, the baby sambar will roam around with its mother, albeit still timid. This creek is too rough for the baby sambar, and it does not want to take a risk. The mother has to return to it. Baby sambars grow fast, and within a short time, heartwarming scenes of family trips can be seen all over the hillside. Mother sambars are more alert at this time, and they always call out and urge the baby sambars to seek shelter together whenever encountering danger. Death and new birth pass down the great mystery of life and carry its natural rhythm. It is an ending and also beginning. It is loss and also gain. It is competition and also collaboration. It is not in opposition, but complementary with one another. It is cyclical, just like the four seasons. Between death and new birth, the traces of life clash with each other and make wonderful sounds, just like a song. And I feel so fortunate to be part of it, as one series of musical notes in this song of life. Meanwhile, as I listen and sing along, I share the secret of this song with you.